went down and the jungle fire was burning. Down the track came a hobo hiking, and he said, "Boys, I'm not turning. I'm headed for a land that's far away, beside the crystal fountains. So come with
me." Hello, this is the Homeless in Aspen show on Grassroots TV. I'm Vince Savage, the director of the Aspen Homeless Shelter. And I always like to start off by saying that we've been around for over 10 years as the Aspen Homeless Shelter. And with a mission of very first thing is we just want to make sure nobody freezes to death in the winter, which has happened in this valley in past years, not under our watch. Our second mission is to try to make sure nobody goes hungry. We want to make sure that there's always a healthy meal every night and snacks throughout the day for people. And then in addition to those two basic missions, we are always happy to try to give everybody who finds themselves without a home, someone sleeping rough as it's called, a hand up into the mainstream. And that can include the fact that we have laundry facilities, showering facilities, a private dedicated phone line that's not answered, homeless shelter. So for people looking for work, it's more like somebody calling them would think they were just getting a roommate on the phone or something like that. And a number of other case management things, you know, almost whatever problem somebody may have that's getting in the way of them finding housing, we do a lot of triage and referral to the Aspen Counseling Center, to any other kind of agency, economic assistance, so on, because our overall goal is to try to get as many people as possible mainstreamed and back into housing. Our current donors, which are basically Douglas Elliman Real Estate and the Little Nell Hotel, as well as Aspen Valley Hospital, several of the churches, and about 10% of our funding comes from the Healthy Community Fund, we have an unwritten promise to take care of our local homeless. Many people donating are happy to help our local people, people with a history here, people with work history here, family. Some of whom may have even been born at Aspen Valley Hospital or graduated Aspen High School. But we have promised most of our donors that we're not about creating a destination resort for homeless people to come from everywhere. About 80% of our homeless population works. However, the reason they're still homeless is because there's a pretty big hump or a barrier to entry, even to get into the most affordable APSHA housing. So our purpose is really to be an emergency stopgap shelter, not a place where people come and stay for years as a substitute for what we should call sustainable permanent housing. But today I've got two guests that really know a lot about what homelessness is about on the ground. I've got Bryan Hadley, who's a ranger supervisor for open space and trails for Pitkin County, and Bryan Long, who's with the city in the same kind of a role. So Pryce and Bryan, welcome. And I just wanted to start off with one little idea here about how people maybe use the woods. We find that in our American culture, there's a long history of people going west whenever life got stressful or cramped for them. They'd buy a Conestoga wagon, a dog and a gun, and head west to where more opportunity and where things, you know, even land given away for free. So I like to think of that metaphor somewhat in terms of our people who find themselves in Aspen but aren't able to quite make the ante to get into housing. So I think one of the ways people do that, legal or illegal, is to head to the woods. So I thought, since you guys, that's definitely your bailiwick, I thought I'd start off by asking you, so what is the problem, you know, with people camping in the woods?
Well, Vince, thanks so much for having us. Sure. As you mentioned, Pryce is the ranger supervisor with Pitkin County Open Space, and I am the ranger supervisor for City of Aspen Open Space, and we work rather tightly together on looking after resource protection on properties owned by our respective programs and a whole lot of properties that are co-owned by our programs. We enjoy a really robust partnership between our boards and our staff, work at a very close level to try and have as far as the public is concerned, it's pretty seamless.
So what you're saying is open space, people don't have to worry whether they're in county open space or city open space because you guys coordinate and handle things somewhat the same, right?
That's the idea. Yeah, so there's a property sign somewhere that'll tell you which one it is, but
or a map.
On the ground, it's pretty seamless. And the properties both of our programs have acquired are largely in the valley floor and close to society. Mm-hmm. You know, when you fly over Aspen at night, you realize that we're in a sea of darkness, and it's just this tiny little populated area. And I've, you know, often pondered like the philosophies of our programs, like why is there a need for the trail system or the parks or the open space when there's so much national forest land surrounding us? But the reality is that a lot of the lands we provide and a lot of the recreational opportunities we provide are what's right at hand for people and where they get their a lot of their recreational experience.
So it's not just the vast blackness you see flying over at night, but there's the developed trails and other things like that.
Yeah, so part of what we have to deal with in being the managers of those lands closer to society is that those lands are sort of the first the first net that some of the homeless populations fall back on when they're trying to find a place to make a camp in you know, in a nook or a cranny out of the public view. Right around the city of Aspen, our programs own those nooks and crannies, and those are the places that we look after.
And these are the lands that are closest to our transit, you know, routes, closest to, you know, any of the services that any member of the public would value. They're a lot more convenient, you know, destinations for people if they're, you know, looking for somewhere to camp. And I just want to step back and say that, you know, our programs are really built on attempting to provide a high quality visitor experience for a diverse array of people. We have people that live here, that we have tourists that come from around the world, and we're trying to serve those clientele all on a pretty small postage stamp sized system. So we definitely recognize, you know, the I guess intrinsic right of people to be out on their public lands, enjoy them. But at the same time, there are certain regulations that have been put in place since 1990 for the county program with the intent to protect the investment of the taxpayer, protect the natural resources, the wildlife habitat, and continue to provide for that that special experience that people have come to expect when they come to the
And that's
mountains.
An interesting concept you bring up, the whole concept of public lands. Mm-hmm. Because we have clients who like to tell us that they're in a public building when they're over in the Health and Human Services building where our day center is. And because of that, by their reasoning, they can do whatever we want, or whatever they want, and we don't have any reason to give them any rules or guidelines for behavior. But I'm sure both of your organizations have just those things in place, some rules and guidelines. And even though our homeless population are also members of the public, the visitor or the second owner or the resident of Aspen that is in housing isn't likely to be out breaking those rules by camping too long or camping at all, I guess.
No, but they may be breaking some of our other rules.
Yeah. Like,
we're asking them to put the dogs on leash.
Teasing moose until you get charged.
Teasing moose is absolutely forbidden.
It's never a good idea.
You know, but everybody is expected to pick up after their dogs and to have dogs leashed when that's the rule, which is just about always, unless there's, you know, in some of Aspen's parks we allow watchful off leash play, but we hold a lot of the public to a framework of rules,
which is an important point. You're not just here just to hassle homeless people.
Absolutely not.
But sometimes I think some homeless people perceive that every authority figure is there to get in their way.
Right? Yeah, I mean, that's understandable given a lot of people's background of experience. We really try to train our staff to treat everybody on, you know, to as much as they can on that even, with an even and fair, you know, ethic. You know, we're trying to engage the billionaire that might be out on Hunter Creek Trail with the same level of respect as we may, you know, somebody that we're contacting that's living down by the Roaring Fork River in an informal camp.
But there's a history here, I guess. Mm-hmm. You said since the 90s, some of these rules have been more codified or clarified. And there are people that have been around here so long. There was the lady whose full name I won't mention, but she was in her late 70s and was camping for 18 years up on the Lanny White Trail near the beginning of that. And they sent me up there when I first started this work, thinking, you know, well, Vince can talk to her. He's a psychologist. And it was quite interesting. Her perception was that she'd been there longer than anybody, and she had a right to be there. And even when we kind of confronted her with the fact that the private land she had been on had gotten sold to, I think, the city or the county, and therefore she had to start abiding by some rules, she said, well, can't I be a trail monitor and pick up gum wrappers and tell people which way it is to Hunter Creek Trail? And we just had a hard time trying to make that curve in the road with her that, you know, things have changed. Mm-hmm. So one of the things I wanted to ask you guys is, what has changed recently? Seems like just in the last year or two, we've had a lot more consciousness, maybe some pressure from somewhere to enforce things more rigidly.
I mean, I think what we're seeing, you know, in this state is, you know, a factor of population growth. I mean, we have greater visitation, we have greater resident population. I mean, the area is growing, and I think that puts greater pressure on the agencies that are tasked with being responsible stewards of the public lands to make sure that the behavior out there, when it's being magnified, multiplied many, many times by, you know, the 500,000 visitors or so that we get to county open space, that we're doing that in a responsible manner, trying to limit impact while preserving people's freedom to enjoy that system.
Because if it's a free-for-all, people who come here to enjoy Conundrum or Maroon Creek or even Hidden Lake or
Hanging Lake.
They don't have the experience that they're really coming for. Mm-hmm. So it makes sense on a practical level, too, to protect it and kind of mollify how many people use it. Are there any other reasons that, I know I've been, I talked at length with some of the county officials a couple of years ago about the worry about fire danger.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think Lake Christine fire was a really important wake-up call for a lot of people in the valley to the risk of fire in our communities. And of course that extends to, you know, our thinking about camps on open space. You know, when you are living in a campsite, informal campsite without infrastructure, you know, any way to dispose of your waste or heat your tent or things like that, you're going to have fires, you're going to have other potential hazards that could start a wildland fire. And there's a lot of precedent for that on the Front Range. The Cold Springs fire in Boulder County is one example that was started evidently by a unattended campfire in a camp off of Peak to Peak Highway. So there's a lot of concern, fear, I guess, that these camps could spark something like that. And that was, you know, definitely brought to the surface in, you know, the last summer due to the really dry conditions.
It does seem that the concerns are valid, yet I think you get disagreement from various stakeholders when you talk about what the solution is. Mm-hmm. I know when I first talked to some of the municipal heads in Pitkin County a year and a half ago about the fire danger, I said, well, our guys aren't crazy. They're not stupid. Well, you know, most of them aren't. And we can have them not build fires. We could buy them little safety alcohol stoves and stuff like that. But that idea didn't go very far. It seems like the drift from county officials is they just want to have a place for homeless people to go, not camping on public land in the warm months.
And there's, you know, a range of impacts from camping, and if you're going to touch on that. But
I just wanted to, you know, mention that I'm agreeing with you, Vince, in the majority of camps that I've visited or cleaned up over 12 years have not had a fire ring or a fire scar. The majority of camps that I've come across are quite minimal.
They're just sleeping.
They're just sleeping, and there's often a tent, and unfortunately there's quite often a good deal of litter and human waste around, but others are better about that and keep a real a real tight thing that they may bundle up each day and move on with, and you didn't even know they were there. But there's only a handful over the years that have had a fire scar. It's that's not the norm.
Yeah, I mean, I've definitely seen really obvious fire risk in some camps. I remember going to a camp in the Shale Bluffs area that had maybe a half dozen propane tanks, and it was evident that at one point, when I was looking at the structure, that a candle had been knocked over, melted, partially burned part of the structure. And this is in an area right below Highway 82 on Airport Ranch.
Bad formula there, right?
So it's, yeah. I mean, while many people are responsible, just like any other subset of the population, there's still an inherent risk. And, you know, we have seen small fires in the valley related to camps, like down in Glenwood Springs, above Walmart. There have been small fires sparked down there, you know, caused by unattended fires in those camps.
Yeah, I knew a guy who had worked for Feed My Sheep down there, and he was homeless himself, and he was up there on the hillside behind Walmart where a lot of people used to camp, and he got up there and started a fire one night, but he wasn't much of a Boy Scout, and he's used a lot of green twigs and stuff to start the fire and created a lot of smoke. So the rest of the guys who were camping up there were ready to kill him because he brought the county mounties and the fire department and everybody up there thinking there was a forest fire started. And all it was a guy that didn't know how to build a good Native American fire out of dry twigs.
And, you know, in addition to the fire risk, we also see, as Bryan mentioned, you know, large amounts of trash that don't get cleaned up on their own. That requires taxpayer dollars to send people like Bryan and I down there with, you know, thick rubber gloves to pack out, you know, sometimes, you know, a dozen contractor garbage bags. I mean, one day I had to actually handline a boat across the Rain Fork River to haul out 8 contractor garbage bags. So, you know, there's a cost, you know, both in terms of impact on the natural resources and cost to our programs to clean up the impacts of some of these camps. In addition to that fire danger, you know, there are also occasionally hazardous items in these camps like syringes or, you know, things like that that are just not pretty and, you know, we have to take into account, you know, and probably when we got into this line of work as rangers, it was something that we didn't anticipate.
You'd forgotten about those irresponsible camping people, whether they're homeless people or anybody camping.
Yeah, anybody can be irresponsible, for sure.
Do you feel like there's been a more recent mandate for you to crack down or do anything differently?
I don't feel that way in the city open space organization at all. We've... you know, from the very get-go, there's been no camping allowed on our properties, and that's the ranger's job to enforce that. But there's always been a whole lot of support from above in us handling that in the most empathetic way that we can and in the most humane way we can and with a light.
What's your most frequent source of complaints or awareness that there's something on it? You just happen across people, or does some hiker call you up and say, you know, there's a couple of guys camping up there, looks like they've been there all summer?
It's about 50-50.
Yeah, I'd say it's a mixed 50-50. Bag. I mean, a lot of these camps, I mean, it seems like half of them or maybe more of them are in pretty obvious places near, you know, transit, near stores, near, you know, all the services that we would want. But then there are also a subset of those camps that are in very hard to reach places that are, you know, only found if rangers come across them or if like fly fishing guides call us, or I've even had a paragliding guide who had seen one from above let us know.
We have often talked about the moral dilemma that we are in, the staff and I that run the homeless shelter, because people who find themselves homeless will think, well, gee, where do I, you know, what do I do at night in the warm months of the year? And we've had to tell them, well, you know, we can provide you with sleeping bags and tarps and things like that, but we're fully aware that we're kind of advocating that they break the rules. So that's kind of a moral dilemma for us, but what we do is we revert to our primary mission, which is we want them to be able to sleep somewhere where they can stay warm and dry, and then we'll keep kicking the can down the road, as being said a lot lately, as to how to solve this problem in the long term, because... you know, we don't have a year-round place for people to sleep indoors. And I've done a lot of focus groups with our homeless population and discovered that even if we did, there's a large number of people who don't want to do that. You know, they said colorful ways of saying it, like, why would we want to be in a cramped in a little room with a bunch of guys that are snoring and other things, when we could have the dignity of having our own pleasant campsite properly maintained and properly, you know, administered, so to speak, instead of having to wait till 9 or 10 o'clock at night to come in and get up at 5:30 to get out, we could, after work, go by the day center, shower, have a good meal, and then go up and read a book until time to go to sleep, and then wake up when we feel like it, get to work. So I have an insight about what some of the people's motives are. They aren't just looking for ways to break rules. They're trying to meld the rules into what works for them.
Yeah, and you know, in the perfect world where we had the, let's say, a year-round shelter or a great safety net all ready to go for folks year-round, even so, there would be some clientele that would seek that freedom and seek to be making a camp in a place where they think they can be
get away with a nook
or a cranny and legitimate or not, not be bothered. But that's it seems like that will always be a part of our role to be enforcing the no camping policy on the open space lines.
Yeah, in addition to like that desire for freedom and, you know, being able to, you know, go by, you know, live how you want to live. There's
my great granddaddy lived in these hills sort of attitude. And it's not totally out to lunch. You know, it's like, okay.
And there's also, you know, things that play like mental illness and substance abuse disorders, and we've seen plenty of that in these camps, and, you know, people perhaps in some cases who are maybe not functional enough to access some of these services, or maybe not, they have a hard time behaving, meeting some of the standards, I guess, that they'd be required to follow.
Well, and you bring up a great point, because even in our population of day center users and our winter overnight users, there's an old, you know, the 80-20 rule in business, you know, that 20% of your people bring you 80% of the profits, and also 20% of your people cause you 80% of the problems. And that's kind of the way it is with us. We have a really good group of people that find themselves homeless, whether it's recently or longer term, who get it. You know, they don't bite the hand that feeds them. They try to live by the rules. They chip in, do a chore. But there are those people, and sometimes it is alcohol and drug addiction, and sometimes it is just mental health or what I like to call attitudinal impairment, like nobody's going to tell me what to do, that cause us a lot of the difficulties. And we're in this other dilemma of, if we have a sign on our wall that says, here's our basic motto, be nice or leave. And if we can't get people by whatever kind of psychological jujitsu we know to kind of behave and be part of the group and be helpful, a group of peers, so to speak, then we may have the only leverage left would be to say, you can't be here. And at that point, then we're risking them putting back in your, you know, handbasket of problems, or the law enforcement per se's, you know, a bailiwick. So we are aware of these difficulties, but we've never been able to completely figure out an airtight solution.
No, and it's something we acknowledge when we make these contacts. We don't have the solution for these folks. We don't have the perfect place to sell them. There's so much variety
in the persons and the personalities and their situations. I mean, some have cars they can sleep in, but where can they actually park? Yeah. You know, we have had problems down at the Intercept lot of, ironically, guys getting so close to the bus stops because they wanted to take advantage of the Wi-Fi that was scaring some of the people who were just waiting for the bus. And at one point, Rafta even suggested, well, we could put in stronger Wi-Fi, and they can move back there behind the Intercept lot and be a little further away than the bus riding public, and problem solved, right? But I'm wondering what you guys think about the idea of a designated camping area for homeless people, because I know some communities, Las Cruces, New Mexico for one, that has just that. They've got about a 2 or 3 acre place that's fenced in to keep the people safe as well as keep it under control. And it's a little warmer down there in the winter, but it still snows, and they have it all set up, and it's run by homeless people themselves. It's all self-policing. If somebody gets in there that's dealing drugs or going crazy somehow, they'll all just come over and say, hay, you know, you're blowing it for the rest of us. But I'm wondering if that, in your estimation, would be a temporary solution or an interim solution somewhere between full-time, year-round room somewhere in a building versus a place where people could go and camp.
There would be a lot of advantages to that. There would also, of course, be a lot of challenges. Neither of our programs philosophically is set up to address or handle that.
We'd have to rewrite some of the rules and some of the procedures.
Well, even in the charter that dictates like how some of these taxes that fund, you know, open space acquisition and management, you know, they put limits on how these lands can be used. So there are legal barriers to that as well.
But would having a designated spot and a designated, you know, camping area that, you know, could be looked after by some sort of staff, and you know, have the knowledge of the law enforcement community to know right where to go if there was an issue, would that be preferable to the sort of cat and mouse game that we find ourselves forced into? In a way, that's that is more attractive.
It might be, and it might be preferable to the idea of what I call running a shelter in some church basement, where it's really kind of like balancing teacups on your knees in a bathtub, because you're in and out. You got to be in at a certain time, out at a certain time. You're dealing with somebody else's space. It may be one big room, difficult to separate men from women, difficult to separate parents with children. But we're so close to out of time, I'm going to have to promise to have you guys back sometime, tell some war stories you have about all this. I personally believe, kind of duh, the solution for local homelessness is local housing. And one of the gaps we have is that, other than the homeless shelter emergency, homeless emergency shelter, our organization, there's no place to graduate people to that's truly affordable, truly low cost. And APSHA does its best to keep the workforce people housed, but for people that are just clawing their way up, it's difficult.
As you say, that's a big jump. There's a gap.
There's a bunch of rungs to the ladder missing, and you have to jump halfway up the ladder.
And I think one thing that kind of connects to all this is that homelessness is a social and community issue, and we really need to be thinking about addressing it at that social and community level. Yeah. It takes all of us, and the agencies that we represent working together to be able to come up with solutions to this problem. And we've got some, we're making some progress with some of the discussion that's happening in the community now, but it can't be solved alone by, the open space programs. And
the dialogue is progressing.
Yeah.
And I hope we get to some points where some very practical solutions are coming here, before too long. I just want to remind our viewers that on July 27th and August 17th, we are at the Saturday Market with a tent where people can make donations, get free lemonade, and buy our nifty T-shirts, which I still didn't get up here at the table this time. But at any rate, we like to, we like to have people stop by and also remind them that we've got a major annual fundraiser coming up at the base of Ajax Mountain, at the base of the gondola, Ajax. At the Ajax, what's it called?
Ajax Tavern,
thank you. Sponsored by the Little Nell and also Douglas Elliman Real Estate. So it's easy to eat up the time when guys as interesting as you are here. So I want to thank you for being here.
Thank you, Vince.
We'll get you back.
Vince, thanks for having me.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Sun went down and the jungle fire was burning. Down the track came a hobo hiking, and he said, "Boys, I'm not turning. I'm headed for a land that's far away, beside the crystal fountain."